Hello, Thomas here from Train Fully. This is our second video in our three-part series dedicated to how we can best direct our efforts to improve your performance and lower your scores. This video is all about enhancing your golf-specific athleticism. We're going to start with an assessment. I want you up against the wall. We'll get your head against the wall, your back against the wall, your butt against the wall. Your feet can be 2 or 3 inches out. I want you to lock your elbows out and bring your arms up right next to your ears and try to touch the wall. Now, we'll go over the things here that would indicate that you failed this test, and we'll talk about what failing the test means for your golf swing in a moment. But if you could not get your head against the wall, that would indicate that you failed the test. Or if you had to tilt your head up to do so, to touch the wall, if you ended up looking up at the ceiling, that would indicate that you failed the test. If you were not able to touch the wall with your hands, that indicates that you failed the test. Or if you had to bend your elbows to touch the wall, that's a fail. If you had to raise your shoulders up, if when you brought your arm up, your shoulders traveled up towards your ears, that would indicate that you failed the test. Or if your low back arches when you try to bring your arms up, that would also indicate that you failed. Now, what does this all mean for your golf swing? Well, we'll dive into that now. All right, so what does that test tell us about your performance? Well, the first thing it tells us, if you fail the test, you have muscle imbalances. And we learned in the last video that muscle imbalances are a waste of your training capacity. So if you haven't watched that video, the first video in this series, go back and watch that now. But we learn more than just that from this test. If you were not able to touch the wall, or if your elbows bent, or your shoulders raised, or your low back arched, those are all compensations. You're compensating for a lack of mobility. And if you have to compensate as you slowly raise your arms up when you're standing against the wall, which is one joint action, by the way, if you have to compensate to do that, what's occurring during your swing? An event that is much, much faster and involves many more joint actions. Well, you can pretty much guarantee that you're going to be compensating. And those compensations manifest themselves as inconsistent striking and swing faults. And that brings us now to the concept of golf-specific athleticism. Now, this is such a huge topic with many layers to it. The purpose of this video is to serve as a starting point, because each sport requires its own type of athleticism. And if you start developing the wrong athleticism for your particular sport, you could end up hurting your performance and potentially causing injuries as well. So, what type of athleticism is required for golf? Well, to excel at golf, you have to hit the ball far and you have to hit the ball accurately. And doing that is 100% dependent on impact conditions, specifically sustaining the line of compression. And to sustain the line of compression means you're going to have to be accelerating through impact, and you're going to have to hit the sweet spot of the club over and over and over again. The nature of golf, more than any other sport, is defined by one repetitive movement, the swing. And so, to excel at golf, we should be directing our efforts at making our swing as efficient and consistent as possible. For your swing to be efficient, it must not have any compensations. But if your swing is going to be compensation-free, your movement must be compensation-free. And this brings us back to the test we did against the wall. If you had to compensate when doing that test, that means you're compensating during your swing sequence, which means it's going to be virtually impossible for you to have an ideal compression line. So I'm going to show you a routine here that we can use to improve the mobility of your shoulder and improve your performance on that test and improve the efficiency of your swing. But for the purpose of demonstration, let's pick one shoulder to do this on so that we can then retest ourselves and notice how much impact the routine has made on our shoulder mobility. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is use either a foam roller, a myofascial release ball, a softball, a crossball, whatever you have, to apply pressure to two areas around your shoulder. We're going to place the device, the ball, foam roller, whatever you have, on the floor, and we're going to position your body so that the ball is just below your armpit near the bottom corner of your shoulder blade. And that area there, so we'll look for the most tender spot. Once you find the most sensitive spot. We're gonna stay on that spot for 2 minutes. Now this spot here, there's two muscles under the ball here when I'm situated like this. Latissimus dorsi and teres major. These two muscles, if they are overactive, and if you are not able to touch the wall without compensating, they are overactive, they are causing all sorts of issues with your swing. So we want to decrease the activity of these muscles. We'll use the foam roller or the ball to do that. Again, find the most sensitive spot. Try to not have any weight on this arm. So all the weight is going directly into the ball, and we'll hold this position for 2 minutes. Okay, now the second spot we want to apply pressure to is just above that first spot, a little bit closer to your armpit. Same setup position, get it on the floor. And we're going right near the top part of your armpit. Now this one, you may need to sort of tilt your body towards the ceiling or the sky. And it's right behind your shoulder. And you'll find a really sensitive spot there. We call this the posterior shoulder. There's a lot of tissues in there. We have your posterior deltoid, infraspinatus, and teres minor are in there, as well as the posterior capsule of the shoulder. So find that most tender spot, and we'll hold that again for 2 minutes. Again, try not to have any weight on this arm. This spot is quite sensitive, I know. You can take some pressure off here if you have to, but let that ball sink right into that area. 2 minutes. Okay, so now that we've completed our release techniques, we're going to move on to corrective stretching. What I want you to do, and again, we're only stretching the one side. So we're going to put either the other hand behind your back or just on the ground. Choose the side that you've been doing the release techniques on, and we're going to do child's pose. So I want your butt to drop back towards your heels, arm out here, and you're trying to bring the elbow in towards the midline of your body, so it's between your knees. Drop your hip right back and reach that arm out, and we'll hold this stretch here for 2 minutes. Okay, so now we have isolated activation. We're going to do isolated activation for our serratus anterior, which is the muscle that connects from the bottom corner of our shoulder blade to our ribs. We'll get you on the ground. And what I want you to do is we'll place your other hand just on your stomach or by your side. The arm that we've been doing the techniques on, I want it on your thigh, thumb up, keep your shoulder down and back, and we're going to bring that thumb up towards the ground. Only bring it as high as you can without compensating. So the compensations that will occur is the elbow bends or the shoulder comes up. Okay, I mean starts traveling towards your ear. So I want you to keep your shoulder down, your elbow locked, and as you come up here, don't let that shoulder come up towards your ears. Hold that for 2 seconds. And then back, keeping the shoulders down and back, elbow locked. And this is actually quite challenging. You may not be able to touch the ground. If you can touch the ground without compensating, what we can do is we make this a little more difficult by tucking your thumb in and see if you can bring your fist back. And if you can do that, what we will do is go palm back again. Only if you can do this without your shoulder migrating towards your ear or you bending your elbow. And we'll do 15 repetitions holding at the end range for 2 to 4 seconds. Okay, so let's redo our test here up against the wall. Head against the wall, back against the wall, butt against the wall. The feet 2 or 3 inches out, elbows locked, and we're going to bring our hands up without letting our shoulders travel towards our ears or our low back arching. And you will probably notice the side we did the intervention on performs a little better now. Now, to really improve your performance on this test, we'd have to address your thoracic spine and other tissues as well. But most people will notice an improvement with that quick intervention. Now imagine if instead of a quick intervention, it was a full intervention, and instead of just your shoulder joint, we applied a full intervention to all of your joints. What type of impact would that have on your movement, and what type of impact would that have on your swing? Well, it would be dramatic. And that's what Train Foley does. It enhances the alignment and functioning of your entire body. and that's referred to as posture. So to recap, the first step in improving your performance and lowering your scores was to play and practice more. The second step is to enhance your golf-specific athleticism, and both steps one and two involve optimizing your posture. If you optimize your posture, you will have the essentials for a high-performance golf swing. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching.